meeting him in his office in Toronto. He's an outstanding resource of personalities. You know, history is made of personalities, events, and the ideas behind it. Iqbal has a collection of thousands of names, people, and personalities, and his work is of immense value to us. So I'd like to invite him to the podium here, in case you're wondering as to what happened to the question and answer session. These are sessions which are information sessions. So what we do is we take questions at the end, so rest assured that there will be question and answer time, but I thought it would be good to actually go through all the presentations, make your notes, so that we can move on. Before, man, please.
So, namaste, Anurat, assalamu alaikum. The Khoja Wiki project is a transnational oral history documentation project. And I'd like to start by defining, by my definition of Khoja's, because it's important to what I'm doing. A syncretic Hindic sect formed when Shia preachers originally from Iran, but later mostly locally, convincing Lohana Hindu traders that Imam Ali, the son-in-law of the Prophet, was the much-anticipated 10th avatar of Lord Vishnu. And this new, perfected Hinduism was styled Satpan. And that, to me, is what was being practiced for as much as 300-400 years among the subcontinent. Satpan was spread by Khoja traders traveling throughout Kutch, later Gujarat, and much later into Sindh, Multan, Punjab, attracting membership by their business attributes. They were considered to be honest businessmen that took care of each other's debts, that took care, they made sure that their reputation was intact. Khojas moved with the times, accompanying Arab conquerors to East Africa, the Portuguese into Goa, Mozambique, the French into Madagascar, last not least, the British into Karachi, Mumbai, Colombo, Malaya, and as far away as Hong Kong and Shanghai. With globalization, migration brought Khojas to Europe and North America. Indeed, there's no continent today where Khoja businessmen and now professionals come to be found. But as a community led by traders and merchants, there was not much of a culture of historians or even just scribes. And there are few records of their great journeys. So what is Khoja Wiki? It's basically a process of recording family oral histories to make them available as archival records for future generations. Secondly, the objective is to provide research materials for historicizing the Khoja diaspora for studies into migration movements, social mores, statistics, and more. Why is it important now? Traditionally, the method of grandmother storytelling is quickly disappearing. Lost memories, the passing of elders, and with that, the oral traditions. The result is a permanent erasure of the only traces of the history and culture as to how it was actually lived. The loss of records as well due to voluntary pro-colonial and community decisions and migrations. Lastly, but not the least, the inaccessibility of community institutional archives assembled through donations of family trees and libraries. Loss of mother tongue, lack of support for the continuity of retaining immediate family and community memories. However, why we're doing this Khoja Wiki now is the internet, which has become a game changer in the whole idea of collecting oral history. So there are new techniques available now to kind of beat the clock on this issue. There's also a greater awareness of what I consider to be the great cultural amnesia amongst the Khoja. If you observe the smiling Khojas, for example, they, to a person, will call themselves the smileys. Whereas the smileys of other persuasion, such as the Pamirs, the Afghans, the Syrians, define themselves by that definition. They will say, I am a Syrian smiley, I am a Persian smiley. Khoja smileys seem to have lost that, the Indic connection that they had, sometimes to a sort of comical situation where people were telling them, yeah, but we're from Iran. So this lack of 6 centuries of stay in India was wiped out by this idea that way back somewhere in antiquity we would have come from Iran. And amongst the Khojashnashis, I think there is also a paucity of material prior to the split. There's a lot of stuff that you can find with respect to their path after the split. But indeed, work being done by, you know, Dr. Walji is directed towards their origins in Kachin-Katiyawar. So, Khoja Wiki Foreman is a grassroots-driven, volunteer-driven civic society Seva entity, which means it's a not-for-profit, secular and distinct from the structures of the Dawa-motivated religious missions. It's a global rich idea so that it can interact with the widely dispersed Khoja families. It's a registered Canadian charity to retain transparency and to solicit long-term assistance from like-minded members of the Khoja diaspora. So it's open, the work is open, it's available to all. Our tools, basically a web-based open presence, khojawiki.org, custom designed software, it's a wiki media interface, but underlying that is a searchable SQL database. So it provides something like a ancestry.com kind of thing, but also it has a wiki page that is editable globally and basically of unlimited size. You can add photographs, you can add documents, you can write as much as you want about any of your ancestors, as much as you know. And the idea behind that is to create family accounts which can be shared, and then these family accounts can be added to over time, because knowledge of our immediate ancestors and long-term ancestors is widespread amongst our families as they are widespread globally. So the idea was that they would be able to add to the body of knowledge that can then be kept for future generations. The website has a sort of a tombstone section too, where you can put down information on birth and death and school and essential data, but a huge page on which you could write down anything really that you want. We've also tried to add essays to the website, essays that we, the little knowledge that we have. Most of us are community historians, we're not scholars like yourselves. So the little essays that you see there are, what was the impact of famines, for example, on the movement to Africa? Something like that, stories about settlement, stories about various places, such as when the Khojas first arrived in Mumbai, or in Dar es Salaam, places like that, and what brought them there. Like I said, it's got a unique password system, so each family can have a password that can be shared, can only be amended by that family, that page, but it's available to everybody. It also has an expanding family tree that can be printed and shared. So to put the record straight, well, I'll tell you what khojawiki.org is not, so some people can rest easy. It's not a social media platform, so there is no communication capability there. It's not designed to tell you where you're visiting Mumbai this week. It's not a commercial marketing venture either. There's no advertising, no marketing, no lists of people being shared. In fact, we have a very great opportunity for our nonprofit to be able to generate an income stream here, because the visits are close to a million people that visit our site, but we shun from that, because that would take away from the very accessibility part of it. It's not a theological spiritual talk show. We're really not interested in you know, whether you said it and said this or that, or you should have said this or that. This is not really what we are about. This is purely a oral record keeping site. We will ruffle some feathers because we will say things that appear to be what we think is a clear history, and maybe not the narrative that as Aida was saying, narratives that are identity narratives that are coming out. Ours will be purely based on what's known out there. And it's not a platform to promote any religious movement or viewpoint. The result is that we've got hundreds of thousands of unique visitors. 25,000 names on the family tree that we've got. And so far we've collected about 250 individual narratives. Narratives of individuals that are there. Some of the narratives have been taken from other sources on the web. Some have been written by our community scholars. Some have come from families that have their own. Some have come from family books that have been printed, published, handwritten about their ancestry. Oh, one person sent me a family tree of a family called Budwanis, and there were 1,700 names there. So they could trace back. I think it's a Mumbai family. Budwanis, Bud was one of their ancestors. We also tried, and the jury is still out on that. We did put out a Khoja Wiki drop-in sort of center in Toronto. Dr. Raj visited that. It was our method was to attract seniors, because we feel that's the most dangerous situation. We're losing seniors, we're losing their stories. So it was a sort of chai chat center for seniors to come in. We had volunteers to help them write their stories. It's been partially successful, partially not. Probably because my location is right across from the Smiley Center and the Alpine Museum, and they would rather go there than here. I'm not really very successful at that, I'm afraid. I have a little bit of a cultural artifact museum. People keep dropping off things that they have accumulated over the years. The seniors, unfortunately, tell me that nobody's interested in those jubas that they got, you know, the red jubas that they got. Well, it seems like the Alpine Museum is not interested in them. There is no place to put them. The young kids are not interested in them. So we've created a little storage of artifacts, hoping that someday someone will come and claim them. Once they become a little more aware of their own personal history as opposed to almond history. We do audiovisual presentations, we do book launches by seniors, anything that really impacts on history in terms of either migratory history, lived history, we will provide a platform. We have a Facebook, which has got about 3,000 plus members. Our stories that we get from seniors, this is where we publish them, on the Facebook and on our Khoja Wiki site. So our publication is that, and each story is then shipped out to these 2,500 people on Facebook. We have a mail out list that I was able to find on the internet. Believe it or not, I found 7,000 names of these smiling Khojas on the internet. So I was able to incorporate that, and now I have a mailing list. Once a month I get 50 people unsubscribing, but there's a big list, so I'm happy with that. We do seniors awareness speaking tours. We done Mumbai, Waterloo, we've done Toronto, Waterloo, Niagara Falls, Calgary in Canada, Mumbai, Pune, Bhuj, Jamnagar, Porbandar in India, Colombo, Sri Lanka. We've reached 2,500 seniors actually in terms of the effort that we put in. And I'm going to tell you about how difficult it is, but in a minute. We published, as I said, memoirs of Khoja seniors. If they want it to be published, we will do it. If they publish it themselves, we'll market it for them. We've done 3 book launches in Toronto with Khoja seniors. So where are we headed? We're headed to, essentially, we would like to move their publication efforts to mass forums like Google Books, Amazon. These are relatively inexpensive places where one can put out what is written. Not that you'll get an audience necessarily, but at least it'll be there for future generations. We're trying to do intergenerational cooperation. This is a unique idea. In Ontario, in Canada, in fact, most of Canada, you can't graduate from high school unless you do, I think, 40 hours of community-oriented service for young people. So we're trying to link the two. We're saying, okay, you go and write your grandfather's story, talk to grandma, get the story out to us, we'll give you a certificate saying that you've done the community service. And the Ontario Education Ministry said, well, that's okay, yeah, that will be fine. So we're trying to do this kind of ways of essentially try to use crowdsourcing as a method. We want to do an audiovisual studio to actually create visual stories of seniors, because we think those would be very impactful if people were speaking themselves, the older folks were speaking themselves, preserving them for future generations, they could hear it themselves from their own relatives. Intern positions from universities. I've had one person come in and work with me for one summer. An ambitious project is a small Gujarati Kachi radio broadcast within the narrow confines of metropolitan areas to encourage seniors to tell their stories, recipes, nataks, poetry. They love this kind of sort of ongoing social chit-chat kind of thing, but at a level where it benefits future generations. So this is something that we're working on. So I want to talk about limiting factors, and this probably ties into some of the things that I had talked about earlier. Community access. This has been one of my biggest problems. There are no workable directories in the Smiling community, at least the Smiling Khoja. That means there is not a single directory. I know you find hard to believe we've been there in Canada for 50 years, but there is no way that one is one you can contact another is one through a dictionary, a directory. So reaching them is very hard. We also find that there's a lot of bureaucratic resistance from the local community. The local communities, Smiley communities in particular, are not used to grassroots initiatives. There is, in fact, a lack of civil society forum within the community, notwithstanding that the Akhan Foundation itself is a civil society institution. But within that civil society institution, if there is another unsponsored organization, such as myself, which is not affiliated with that, then there is not much support for this work. I mean, the other thing that's really bugging me is that I find that the seniors have really resigned themselves to a very low self-esteem in Western societies, which are very fast-paced. They find that their self-worth is diminished. There's not very much they can contribute in terms of the day-to-day life that's going on around them, not even in education. They can be babysitters if they like for their grandkids, but they really don't have much they can do. So they look at themselves and they say, well, who wants to know my story? I'm a nobody. I'm just telling him, sitting in the corner there. Nobody really wants to know. And then the other part that really puts a knife through me is this. I say, well, our religious institutions tell us the most important stories that we need to know. So they know all about the saints and the fakirs and the guys and the missionaries and all of those people, but they don't want to know what grandmother who made this massive sacrifice to get them to where they are. It just kills me, you know? That kind of lack of personal self-esteem, particularly in the West, where they are supposed to be able to express themselves. One last comment I want to make is that I consider this one of the priorities of this project is the idea of Khoja women as an exceptional breed in terms of the fact that they have been full participants with the man for as far back as you can remember in the economic fare of the family. So whether it was in rural Dutch Gujarat where they were participants in communal family farms, or as trading communities as they were out there in Africa. Khoja women were never in Perth. They were always out there at Tampi. The Hindu traders would not be able to take their wives over the Kalapani, but the Khojas were able to do it. So they arrived in East Africa fully equipped, and within a couple of years, the spouse would be ready to run the shop, and the husband would then be out there hustling for either he's getting produce together or doing wholesale work, and that really accelerated their economic output. And that was a very, very significant legacy which hasn't been acknowledged in our communal narrative. Thank you very much for listening.